The Russian invasion of Ukraine has resulted in a large amount of fear, confusion, and panic, as many South Africans struggle to understand the situation and its potential impacts on South Africa. Now, this conflict has a long and complicated history that it would be impossible for me to cover all the nuances of in just one video. However, I will be trying to cover some of the basic history, the current situation, and the potential implications for South Africa. To start off, one needs to understand that before Ukraine was Ukraine, an independent state, it was a part of the USSR. It was a Soviet state. And even before it was a Soviet state, Ukraine has long historic ties with Russia and was under Russian control for many centuries. And that is why today there are many people living in the independent state of Ukraine who actually consider themselves ethnically Russian and speak Russian at home as a first language. And this shared history with Russia has actually resulted in the topic of Russia being quite a touchy and divisive subject in Ukraine. There are some people in Ukraine who look back on the time that it was a part of Russia fondly and see a sense of shared culture and heritage with Russia. However, there are also those in the Ukraine who look at Russia and see an imperial force, one that is a source of historic subjugation of Ukraine. The other thing that is important to understand when it comes to this conflict is NATO and its role. NATO is the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and it is a military alliance between states of the North Atlantic. This includes countries like the US, the UK, Canada, France, and Germany. NATO was originally established during the Cold War to act as an opposition to the USSR. As a military alliance, there is an agreement amongst NATO members known as Article 5 that states if any one member of NATO is attacked, then all other members of NATO will come to that country's defense. This makes it seem as though NATO is a purely defensive military alliance. And while it is a defensive military alliance, it is not purely defensive, and NATO has actually engaged in offensive military action in the past. NATO has previously been involved in conflict in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Libya, to name just a few. Now, the reason why NATO is relevant to the current conflict is because in addition to having many Western European member states, NATO has also been slowly expanding further and further eastward since the end of the Cold War. This map shows some of the states that have joined NATO since the end of the Cold War in 1991. And it can be seen that the influence of NATO is growing further and further eastwards, and that NATO has incorporated many states that were previously under the Soviet sphere of influence. NATO's eastward expansion has been of serious concern to Russia and particularly to Putin. They view this eastward expansion of NATO as a massive security threat. The further eastwards NATO has expanded and the more military activity they have engaged in these eastern countries, the greater tensions between Russia and NATO have grown. For several years, Ukraine has had aspirations of NATO membership and of greater integration with the European Union. This has been of massive concern to Russia, who has seen the possibility of a former Soviet state being part of NATO as a major security threat. Putin has even claimed that at the end of the Cold War, the US agreed that NATO would not expand to include former Soviet states. However, this is a disputed point. Now, with that important context, we can move on to the start of this conflict, which is actually all the way back in 2014. Up until 2014, Ukraine had been ruled by a pro-Russian government. And in 2014, this government rejected a deal that would bring about greater integration with the European Union. That decision triggered anti-government protests in Ukraine and a coup that was backed by the US and the European Union. This resulted in the pro-Russian government in Ukraine being replaced with a government that was a lot more friendly to the US and the West. And it was this that led to the 2014 Russian annexation of Crimea. A few days after the pro-Russian president was ousted, separatist groups started seizing government buildings in Crimea. Russian forces invaded and began occupying Crimea. And a plebiscite was held so Crimeans could determine if they wanted to remain a part of Ukraine or if they wanted to be annexed by Russia. A majority of Crimeans voted in favor of the annexation, and Crimea is still annexed by Russia to this day. There are some obvious concerns over the legitimacy of this vote, with many pointing to the fact that Crimea was under Russian occupation when this vote took place. And there were also reports that some of the alleged Crimean separatists were actually Russian unmarked forces. However, they were still legitimate Crimeans who legitimately wanted to become a part of Russia. It's just difficult to know the exact numbers of how many of those people there were. Now, in addition to separatists in Crimea, there are also separatists in other eastern parts of Ukraine. The Ukrainian government has been in conflict with separatist forces in the eastern and mostly Russian-speaking part of Ukraine, known as Donbas, since 2014. These separatist regions are self-declared as independent and have been backed by Russia since 2014. Now, let's fast forward to 2021 and the current Russian invasion of Ukraine. Since 2021, the Ukrainian president has been urging the US and President Biden to allow Ukraine to join NATO. This is obviously very upsetting for Russia and for Putin, who have been steadily moving troops towards the Ukrainian border since the beginning of 2021. Russia wants a legally binding agreement from the US and NATO, promising that they will not pursue military action in Eastern Europe and particularly in Ukraine. The US has refused to agree to this. And as a result, tension has been escalating in the region over the past year. And this tension all came to a head and culmination on Thursday, the 24th of February, 2022, when Russia invaded Ukraine. Putin has claimed that the Russian invasion of Ukraine is an attempt to defend the separatist groups in eastern Ukraine. However, it is widely believed that Putin's true motives are regime change in Ukraine to implement a government that would be more friendly towards Russia. The impact of this conflict will likely be devastating for many people living in the region. Many Ukrainian citizens are fearful for their lives, and there are already reports of an influx of Ukrainian refugees into other European nations. And that is pretty much the situation, or at least as it stands on the 25th of February. So, now that we have more of an understanding of the history of the conflict and what is actually happening, we can look at the potential implications that this conflict may have on South Africa. The South African government has made two statements in response to the events as they have been unfolding. On the 23rd of February, before Russia actually invaded Ukraine, the Department of International Relations and Cooperation released a statement noting their concern about the escalating tension in the region. The statement read as follows: "The South African government is concerned about the ongoing tensions in the Ukraine and Russia border, a situation, if allowed to further deteriorate, could have regional and global ramifications. SA urges all parties to devote increased efforts to diplomacy and to find a solution that will help de-escalate tensions and avert armed conflict." The statement also called on the UN Security Council to play a central role in helping to achieve peace, stating, "The UNSC is the body given the mandate for maintenance of international peace and security, and it must exercise its role fully. As South Africa, we believe all the issues of concern to any of the parties must be addressed in inclusive talks led by the UNSG." Durko concluded the statement by saying, "The world does not need another war, as that will result in death and destruction, hence our call for enhanced diplomacy." Then, after the news of the Russian invasion broke, South Africa released another statement. This statement called on Russia to withdraw its forces from Ukraine, stating, "South Africa calls on Russia to immediately withdraw its forces from Ukraine in line with the United Nations Charter, which enjoins all member states to settle their international disputes by peaceful means in such a manner that international peace and security and justice are not endangered." The statement continues, "South Africa emphasizes respect for the sovereignty and territorial integrity of states. As a nation birthed through negotiation, South Africa is always appreciative of the potential dialogue has in averting a crisis and de-escalating conflict. In line with our strong commitment to the peaceful resolution of conflict, South Africa urges all parties to devote increased efforts to diplomacy and to find a solution that will help avert further escalation." President Cyril Ramaphosa has also stated that he is trying to engage in diplomatic talks with Russia and the US in order to try and help de-escalate the situation. So, those are our official government statements and South Africa's official position on the conflict. Now, there have been many rumors circulating on social media about what this conflict actually means for South Africa and how we will be impacted. One of the major rumors that has been circulating on social media is that because South Africa has a relationship with Russia through BRICS, that South Africa will be obligated to join in this military conflict. This is completely untrue. BRICS is not a military alliance in any sense, and more so represents loose economic ties between the BRICS nations. And as such, there is absolutely no way that South Africa could be compelled to join Russia in this military engagement simply through our membership of BRICS. It is true that South Africa has friendly relations with Russia. However, again, this does not obligate us to become involved in their military conflicts. The impact that our relationship with Russia is most likely to have is that we will not see any statements from South Africa fully condemning the Russian invasion of Ukraine. South Africa has obviously called on Russia to withdraw troops, but if you'll notice in the statement, there was no actual condemnation of Russia's actions. Which is a nuance that kind of shows that South Africa is somewhat towing the line and trying not to anger Russia too much with our response. Additionally, South Africa's relationship with Russia means that despite the requests of Ukraine, it is pretty unlikely that South Africa will actually implement any sanctions, or at least any meaningful sanctions against Russia. However, once again, there is almost no chance that South Africa will become militarily engaged in this conflict. Now, in addition to this idea that South Africa could somehow become engaged in this conflict because of our association with Russia through BRICS, there has also been somewhat the opposite spreading on social media. There is a post claiming that because of South Africa's statements calling on Russia to withdraw from Ukraine, that Russia is now planning on invading South Africa. This post is completely untrue. And there really is no reason for Russia to invade South Africa at all. Putin did threaten that countries that interfere in the conflict would see consequences. However, this threat was most likely aimed at Western nations. The statements that South Africa has released so far really do not go to the extent of interference in the conflict. And there is really nothing for Putin to gain by invading South Africa. There is really nothing for him here. So it would be pretty pointless. The statements that South Africa has released so far really do not go so far as to the extent as to be considered interfering. And although President Ramaphosa has said that he will be engaging with both the United States and Russia in order to try and help with diplomatic negotiations, this is pretty standard practice. And again, nothing that Russia is actually going to invade South Africa over. So overall, the chances of South Africa being militarily impacted by this conflict are almost zero. And if you are South African or living in South Africa, there is absolutely no need to worry that this conflict will affect you in any physical or military sense. However, this does not mean that the conflict will have no impact on South Africa. The impact that we as South Africans will see from this conflict will be primarily economic impact. Russia is a major exporter of crude oil, and as such, this conflict is threatening the supply of crude oil, which will make prices increase, especially if this conflict is not resolved quickly. And as such, South Africans might expect to see the petrol price rise more than it already has. We can also expect to see higher food prices, as well as a slightly weaker rand. And we also have some significant foreign investment in Russia, some companies that have pretty major operations there that will probably take a big hit from this conflict. Now, obviously, this is not great news for South Africa. Our economy is already struggling enough as it is and doesn't really need the extra hit from this conflict. However, in the grand scheme of things, we are in a relatively lucky position that because of our location and our relations to these major powers, that we are not in any direct line of fire as a result of this conflict. And that is where I will end this video. Like I mentioned in the beginning, there is no way that I was going to be able to cover absolutely everything in terms of the history, the situation, and the potential implications and impact. But I have done my best to touch on some of what I feel are the most important points, and hopefully you can come away from this video feeling at least a little bit more informed about what is going on. Like I said, we are in a relatively lucky position as South Africans. Unfortunately, that cannot be said for the many people living in Ukraine and Eastern Europe who are being directly and devastatingly impacted by this conflict. And for their sake, I hope that this conflict can be resolved quickly and with as little bloodshed as possible.